So what is the concept of valuation? Now, per se, let me ask you this question. What do you mean by value of an asset? Okay, in the initial chapters that I had discussed about how to analyze a particular security and all that, now we are taking back to the basics and just recapping what is the basis of a value. Now, why we need to have valuation would actually give the answer for what is value of an asset. Why we need to have valuation? Because as an investor or as a person who is going to buy that particular asset, what is that objective that we would have? Always, we need to go and purchase that asset which is actually lower priced in the market. So there must be something called as an actual value somebody is ready to pay for a particular asset. What do you mean by actual value? So what is that as an investor you would be ready to pay for a particular asset? It is nothing but present value of the future returns that particular asset is going to give you. So this is the fundamental of all valuation. Value or the real value is nothing but present value of future returns of a particular asset. Now, what could be an asset? Asset could be anything. It could be a physical asset or it could even be a financial asset. A physical asset could include a house, a car, or a financial asset could be a share, a security, a particular bond, mutual fund, whatever it is. So all these assets, the basic concept remains the same. What is the basic concept? Whatever you are going to pay for a particular asset would be the present value of its future returns. Now, when it comes to a physical asset, let's think of it. As an investor, I'm not going to use this particular asset, but as an investor, I want to invest in a property. And I would check how much is that the property is going to give me in the future. If at all there is an option to give it on rent, rent is something that I'm going to get in the future. And is that all? No, I'm going to sell this asset off after some particular period of time. And when I'm selling this particular asset, I'm going to get a redemption value. That's a name that I'm giving for that. When I'm selling this asset, I'm going to get something and I'm going to get periodic returns as a rental. So I have to calculate what would be the today's value for these future returns I'm going to get. And that is what I'm ready to pay, or that is the actual value of an asset. Now, how to derive value? There are two type of values that you need to learn. One is intrinsic value, which we learned in the earlier chapters. And we have something called as market price. What's the difference between intrinsic value and market price? We need to understand. Now, what is an intrinsic value? Let's read this. How much is the true worth of an asset is called as intrinsic value. Like I've been talking about real value of an asset. How much is that? The actual value an asset could derive from the market is called as intrinsic value. But because of various reasons, it is not necessary that every asset would be valued at its correct value in the market. So market price could be different. So what a person is ready to pay for that particular asset is called as market price. So what you are going to pay is called as market price, and what you really get is called as intrinsic value or real worth of an asset. So both of this can be derived differently. So sometimes, or in the longer run, our assumption is that the asset that is going to have a market price today would ideally move to get to its intrinsic value in the future. Okay, this is the overall idea that I will be telling you in the frequent discussions we are going to have. Now let's take an example and try to understand this. I told you there could be two type of values, intrinsic value and then market price. Now let's try to calculate how do you derive at the present value of your future returns. Like I told you, how much you're ready to pay today depends on how much you're going to get in the future. So what are the things that you're going to get? Let's summarize it. I told you will get periodic returns. For when it comes to a house, I told you there are rental incomes that you're going to get, which we are going to call it as periodical returns. And we are going to get a redemption value while we are selling that particular asset as such in the future. So these two things are actually lying in the future. So what is that? The present value of these would be the value of a particular asset. Now let's take some number and try to discuss this. Say you have planned to purchase an asset today which is promising 100 per annum for next 4 years, and end of fourth year you're going to receive a redemption of 1200. Now we are going to derive at what could be the value that you're going to pay for this particular asset today. Okay, let's discuss this. So what is that I told you? You have 4 years, you wanted to calculate value today. So today I'm going to earmark it as year zero. So you need value for today. So I told you it depends upon how much value you're going to get in the future. Then I told you in the future you're going to have two type of returns. One is called as periodic returns, and the next one is called as redemption value. So in our example, I told you that in the 4 years to come, you're going to get an yearly income of 100 rupees each. So year 1, year 2, year 3 and year 4, I'm going to get a periodic return of rupees 100 each. And at the end of year 4, you're also going to get 1200 rupees because you're going to sell this particular asset off. So which means your holding period for this particular asset is considered to be 4 years. Now my question to you is this: can I just derive at the value by adding all this? No, we already know that the value that we have in different time horizon cannot be clubbed together, because there's a concept called as time value of money. So I need to derive at present value of all this. What do you mean by present value? Value today. So that would be the value that you are going to pay for that particular asset today. Now how do you derive at the present value is the next question that you have. So anything that is lying in the future, to derive at the present value, I require something called as a discount rate. So next set of understanding should be to pick this particular discount rate and discount all these particular incomes and derive at value today and sum it all. That would be the value of that particular asset today. So this is a generic understanding of this particular calculation. So this would follow for all type of asset. Now let us move to in detail calculation of each of these values. Now I wanted to get into the next set of concept called as return concept. Now in any security valuation, you have two type of returns that frequently come across your discussion. One is called as required rate of return. Another one is called as expected rate of return. Now how I'm going to discuss this chapter across is that we're going to number each of the term that we're going to discuss. Also, we will number the formulas that we're going to discuss, so that end of the discussion, we can summarize all of this. So the term one that I'm going to teach you today is required rate of return, and term two is expected rate of return. Now let us bring an understanding on these two terms. What is required rate of return? See, as an investor, you are putting money into this particular security. So when you put money into security, you have a cost associated with this particular money that you have. So this particular money that you have would come with a cost. So how much is that minimum return that the security should give for that particular investor is called as a required rate of return, which means it could be the cost of capital of that particular investor. Or we can put it in this way: what is the opportunity cost? That the investor has for this particular security. Because if he is not investing in this particular security, he could have put this particular money in some other security. Now if at all he has put this particular security, put this particular money in some other security, he would receive an income. So at least that income is something that we need to compensate for him. So this is what is called as required rate of return. Now generally you have this term interchangeably used with another term called as expected rate of return. So expected rate of return is rather a concept from the investor perspective. So how much is that investor expects from this particular security? Depending upon that, he would actually prefer to pay that particular security in the market. So we'll get a little more understanding on this with some examples in the later slides. Before that, let us try to recap. Required rate of return is the concept that is being used for valuation, or there is one of the return concept which says how much that the investor expects out of a particular security that he invests. So he has an opportunity cost or he has a cost of capital. So minimum required rate of return for him to put the money into your security is called as required rate of return. Now let us try to understand what is expected rate of return. So this is from the investor perspective. So investor says my required rate of return could be different from my expected rate of return. So say he has a required rate of return or cost of capital say 10%, and based on this, this is security valued at 100 rupees. So this is a security which is giving 10% return at 100 rupees. But if his expectation on this particular security is, say for example, 15%. So if his expected rate of return is 15%, will he be ready to pay the same 100 rupees for this particular security? No. So he will be ready to pay less than 100. What could be the reason? Because if he is getting 10% return on rupees 100 that he is paying, his required rate of return only is matched 10%. But how much is that he is expecting? 15%. So anyway, this particular security is going to give 10 rupees as a return because its value is 100 and it is going to give 10% return. Say this 10 rupees return for rupees 100 investment is 10% only. How much he wants? He wants 15%. So he would say that I would pay you much, much lesser so that I get a 15% return even if you are giving me 10 rupees. That is how expected return is being calculated. So which means the market price will be derived based on my expected rate of return. Okay, we will have a little more understanding on this. Okay, so let's put a formula on how to calculate what is the expected rate of return. So formula number one, which says expected rate of return is equal to required rate of return less based on my expectation. What would I do? I would actually be ready to pay less than the actual value or more than the actual value. Say it is giving me, in the earlier discussion, it is giving me 10% or rupees 10 and I want only 8%, then I'll be even ready to pay more than 100 for this particular security. So I would actually change the intrinsic value and the market price based on how much is my expectation. So expected rate of return is required rate of return plus intrinsic value minus price in the market divided by market price. So where ERT is expected rate of return. and RT is required rate of return. And V0 is intrinsic value. And P0 is considered to be the market value. Okay, so the first formula that we need to learn is how to calculate expected rate of return. We used to call the difference between expected rate of return and required rate of return to be alpha. And this concept we will discuss later. But the difference is called as alpha, and that is mainly because of the price difference. And what is that I told you would happen in the long term? The price has to go and converge into the intrinsic value. So at that time, expected rate of return would actually realize that particular additional return because of the price difference. So the security is going to give me only this, and I'm going to get this additional return because of the price differences. This is understanding. Okay, so expected rate of return is required rate of return plus intrinsic value minus market price divided by market price. So this would give me another return. So we'll try to calculate a particular question, and then we will improve our understanding on this. Okay, now let's read the question. This is an example question for you. Suppose that the current price of a share of ABC Limited is rupees 30 per share. And the investor estimates that the intrinsic value, the actual value of ABC Limited's shares to be rupees 35 per share with required return of 8% per annum. Estimate the expected return of ABC Limited. So here the calculation says the current market price is 30. And the intrinsic value of this particular share is 35. Okay, though the intrinsic value, which is in the future, is 35, the currently market is giving me only 30, which means my required rate of return is only 8%. So with required rate of return of 8% and it is giving 35 rupees, it is actually having the value of 35 rupees, but still the investor is ready to pay 30 only, which means he wants more than 8% as return. Now let's try to analyze this question and calculate what is the expected rate of return with our formula. So let's try to understand the value given. So they said required rate of return. How much is required rate of return? Which we call as RT is only 8%. And intrinsic value, which we call as V0, is rupees 35. But market price is only rupees 30, which means market wants, or the investor wants, more than 8%. That is why for a share actually valued at 35, he's ready to pay only 30. Okay. So how do I calculate what is expected rate of return? So we have our formula. What is our formula? Expected rate of return is equal to required rate of return plus intrinsic value minus price divided by price. So what is my rate of return, required rate of return? It is 8%. What is my intrinsic value? 35, wherein my market price is only 30 divided by 30. So which means 8% plus, I'm getting an additional return of 35 minus 30 is 5 divided by 30. So which means that is 8% plus 16.67%, 5 divided by 30. So which makes it the expected rate of return is 24.67%. So what is your understanding on this? It says expected rate of return is 24.67. So even the current market price is 30 today, in the future it is going to give me a return of 24.67, because that's my expected rate. So which means ideally from 35 it is going to grow only at 8%, but I'm not ready to pay 35 today. I'll be paying only 30 rupees because I don't want 8%. I want 24.67%. That's my expectation. You guys are with me? Okay, good. So let's try to understand this. If that's the case, what is the market price today? It is 30. So what would be the, say we will take a time horizon of 1 year for our example. If that's the case, what will be the market price after an year? It should be 30 plus 30 into 24.67%, which means it should be 30 plus 7.4, which means it should be 37.4. So the price of this particular share should be 37.4, so that the 24.67% expected return is met. You're with me, right? So this is the main understanding between expected rate of return and required rate of return. So our formula is expected rate of return is equal to required rate of return plus intrinsic value minus market price divided by market price.